Well, we're in a series now entitled Bridge the Divide. And this is our second Sunday. It's one that, I say this every new series, but it's the most important series I've ever preached. And I do believe that, I do feel that in my heart that, this is a word for us in due season. And this is something crucial to the unfolding plan of God, and that is that we resolve the differences that divide us as Americans, or the greatest nation on this earth that has ever existed, the most prosperous and the most influential on a global scale that has ever existed, will become a goat nation. Will cease to exist in the form that we know it if something isn't done about the polarity, the division, the poison that has infected our society here in America. And essentially, that would be a real, I can only imagine, that would be a real sad thing to the heart of God. He's brought America into existence for the purpose of being the springboard of the gospel into the rest of the world. And as no nation ever has, we have financed or sent forth missionaries over 90% of the mission outreaches into this world. It has come from America. We have been founded on the principle of the Judeo-Christian ethic. A University of Houston study in the 70s established clearly that the source material for our founding documents, our Constitution, our Bill of Rights, 80% of the source material is from the Bible. So we are a Christian nation, no matter what anybody else may have said. We are a Christian nation. We've been founded that way, and we've been used that way by the Lord. And now, you look around at what's happening in America, and your heart begins to grieve. And it's that at that point in personal prayer some months ago, the Lord made clear to me that He can't do anything about America. He doesn't act independently or sovereignly to bring His purpose to pass in the earth. He's got a small window of sovereign operation laid out for us in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Otherwise, He acts through the cooperative will of humanity. And secular humanity isn't going to cooperate with Him. So the people that he's in covenant with, most significantly in this day, the church is His change agent in the earth. Amen. The church is. He works through the church to get His purpose done. And so when the church is as divided in their own way as the secular arena is, He has nothing to work through. And so He spoke to me and He said, when the church comes together in concord, harmony, and agreement, then His power will be in evidence to bring America to the place America needs to be. Amen. Well, so, we are focusing on this, during this series, Bridge the Divide. The importance of bridging whatever divided relationships exist in your life. Relationships on a personal level are, right up at the top of the list in importance to you, to your experience of life. I mean, we remind ourselves that the will of God for our own personal life, is going to come through another person. Things that other people do, say, motivate us to do, go, I mean, it's through other people that the Lord brings His will and His blessing to bear. And of course, if your relationships are divided, He has just that many fewer channels through which to work to gain cooperation of a human will to do something important to His will for your life or His blessing for your life. Relationships are huge. You know, when you talk about the things that are important to us as believers, in terms of realizing the will of God or the blessing of God. You know, first, of course, is being born again. You got to change families, move out from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of His dear Son. But then after the new birth, you've got to be filled with the Holy Spirit. The baptism of the Holy Ghost not only endues you with power, but the Holy Spirit is the agent of revelation in your life, God's revelation. So you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, you got to get it right with your money. Because He said that's the least that He requires of you, meaning the next thing. And the reason is most Christians that get off course where money's concerned. They're too attached to it. They can't trust God in it. And so they wind up serving mammon instead of the Lord. And so the third most important thing, and this is just my opinion, because I've seen a lot over 40 years of ministry. And you know, when people backslide, when people go the wrong direction, when people leave the work of God, when people just don't go anywhere in the will of God, it is most usually on a fundamental level related to money. They don't want to hear about the tithe. They don't want to hear about sowing seed beyond the tithe. They don't want to be told what to do about their money. And of course, it's not up to me to tell you what to do about money. But since I preach the Word and God tells you what to do about money, you're going to hear about it. And it's hugely important that you do. But then right behind that, or maybe it's before it, I'm not real sure, but relationships. Because everything God does for you, to you, to encourage you, to direct you, to lift you up, to bring blessing to bear to you is through people. It comes through people. So to the extent that you become relationally skilled, you will experience the blessing of God. And by being relationally skilled, I mean this. You learn to bridge the divisions that exist between you and the people that God has joined you with. God hadn't joined you with everybody you bump into. You're going to bump into a lot of people that, you know, are the wrong kinds of influence in your life. But the people that God joins you with, He joins you with other believers. He joins you with the local church. There's a place that it's pleased Him to put you. He's joined you with your wife, with your kids, with your family. And so where God has joined you, it behooves you to deal with any issues that divide you from those that He's joined you to. And this is crucially important for America. And for America to be and do and go where God intends, it's vital that we come to a place called one accord. One accord. We see it from the beginning of the book of Acts in the formation of the New Testament church, which changed the known world. It absolutely transformed humanity. And God did that for one reason. They functioned in those early days in a place the Bible calls one accord. Read through a few verses last Sunday, going to read through them again. So if you brought your Bible, open your Bibles with me to Acts chapter 1. If you didn't bring your Bible, it should be on the screen there. But in Acts chapter 1, the Lord ascends into heaven to be at the right hand of the Father, about 500 witnesses to that ascent. And He had instructed them to wait on the endowment of power from on high. About 120 of them did. And it says in verse 14, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication. And we see that continuing into chapter 2, verse 1 says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with, say it, one accord in one place. And as they proceeded to remain in this condition called one accord, It says, suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. It filled all the house where they were sitting. There appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire. It sat upon each of them. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost, began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. And now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded because that every man heard them speak in his own language. So, you know, the Holy Ghost came in power. And of course, the miraculous began to unfold. To what point? Just so God could show out a little bit? No, he had a point. He had a purpose. Peter got up and preached a sermon. Peter, the one who lived with his foot in his mouth, Peter got up and preached a sermon that was so dynamic, so anointed, so power-filled. It says in verse 41, that 3,000 people got saved. Amen. And then in verse 46, it says, they continuing daily with what?
One accord.
Say it.
One accord
in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Because of this one condition called one accord. One accord, if you looked up the Greek word, it's homothumadon, and it has a very simple definition. It means literally to rush along in unison. To rush along in unison. It also is defined as one mind. It's defined as unanimous. But I like the rush along in unison because it describes the dynamic that is generated by one accord, or that is one accord. It is moving quickly in unison. And we see in the example of Scripture, it's toward the manifestation of God, God's power, the miraculous, the supernatural, that changes the world. And it all happens by being in one accord. We see more in chapter 4, verse 23. Peter and John had been arrested by the Sanhedrin, and they had, been questioned and interrogated. And they told them they didn't want them preaching anymore in the name of Jesus. And so when Peter and John were released, they returned to their own company. Now, at this point in time, there were thousands of believers that had been added to the church already, but they had a particular company. They had a place they were to go. And so we see from the earliest record of Scripture, there are companies of believers, called churches, that it pleases God to put you in. You can't ever find this place of one accord, which is the prime contributor to the will of God in the earth and the prime contributor to your own blessing. You'll never find this place of one accord until you find your own company. That's where it can occur. It isn't automatic. There are things we have to understand and do in order to arrive at this place, but you won't arrive in this place if you don't have your own company. But when you do, it says they return to their own company. Verse 24, when they heard what had happened to Peter and John, they lifted up their voice to God with
one accord.
And then, of course, they prayed from the strength of that place. And it says in verse 31, when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. The building shook. I haven't seen any buildings shaking lately, which is a commentary on where we are not as the body of Christ. But that wasn't all that occurred. It said they were filled with the Holy Ghost and spoke the word of God with boldness. Now, they'd already been filled with the Holy Ghost once. This refers to the ongoing fullness of the Holy Spirit that is the will of God for us. And they were filled with the Holy Ghost, spoke the word of God with boldness. Verse 33, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. The grace of God, the unmerited favor and blessing of God One of those manifestations we see in verse 34. Neither was there any among them that lacked. Everybody had everything they needed. There was no need. They hadn't been praying about God meeting their need. They just got in a place called one accord, and it happened. And we see in, you know, the signs, the wonders that everybody that loves the Lord covets, right? In verse 5, chapter 5, verse 12, it says, by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders wrought among the people, and they were all with one accord. I'm glad y'all are following along. One accord in one place in Solomon's porch. In verse 14, it says, believers, this is because they were in one accord. Believers were added to the Lord, multitudes both of men and women. So we see exponential expansion. Tell me the joke, honey. What's so funny? I can't stand it. I see you being happy. I want to share in your happiness. I'm just teasing you guys. Here we go. Keep laughing. That's good. But we see then that, we see the church being exponentially exploded and increased supernaturally by God. It wasn't anybody's great evangelism program. It was the Lord because they were in one accord. And what else did they see? They saw a lot of signs and wonders and miracles. Verse 15 again says, insomuch that they brought forth the sick into the streets, laid them on beds and couches, and at the least the shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them. Power, miracles, signs, wonders, dramatic increase to the church, such that it changed the whole known world in this day. This is the same pattern that we can expect to bring God on the scene in our nation today or anywhere else in the world. You know, surely a lot of people in here pray for revival. But I would suggest that's just one element that is required of us to hunger for the outpouring of God, for the presence of God, the Spirit of God. The other element is to be in a place called one accord, to find that place where we rush along together in unison. Nobody out of lockstep. No murmuring, complaining, criticism, dislikes, animosities, resentments, unforgivenesses. No, in unison, in harmony, in concord, in agreement, one heart, one mind, striving together. And so that's what this series is about. Well, that was a 17-minute review. I'm sorry for that, because that means you're going to be here 17 minutes longer than I had originally intended. But the truth of the matter is, I just can't resist reviewing, you know? So that's really it's like I want to be sure everybody's on the same page. And so essentially, Bridge the Divide is about coming to a place of one accord. And I had a couple of graphics prepared just to, sometimes it's good to look at something, but as you see on the screen, there are three basic steps toward being in one accord. And, these are real simple. God doesn't make it tough, but we have to eliminate divisive influences first. Yes. You can't just eliminate division. Bridge the Divide might not be a great title because it seems to imply that you just got to not be divided. But that's not the case. You can peacefully coexist with somebody that you're not one heart, one mind striving together with. You can eliminate division by occupying the same spaces if that's what the Lord has called you to do, but not really being in this place called one accord. But you do have to eliminate divisive influences first before one accord is even possible. Then secondly, you commit to a common cause. And we will be talking about how that determination is made, what cause you're to embrace, how you find and discover causes that we're supposed to be engaged in and then commit to them. And then thirdly, praying together. Prayer together is the only way God can supernaturally bind hearts and ultimately loose the corporate anointing. You may not like prayer a whole lot. There was a time in my life when I made every effort to delegate my family's prayer life to my wife and let her do it. She liked it and was better at it, but you can't. I mean, prayer has to be a part of our lives. It just means communion with God on the level of spirit to spirit, heart to heart. And that has to be there if God's going to bind hearts together. It's not going to be outside or exclusive of the arena of prayer. And it is that joining together with a common cause, having eliminated divisive influences, that looses the power of God in this earth. So today we're going to talk a little bit about eliminating divisive influences. And of course, the process of eliminating divisive influences, I suppose, is something that many might have an opinion about. But the only opinion that matters this morning is mine, so listen up. Amen. And, you know, there are really prime contributors to eliminating division. Put up the next graphic, if you would, please. I forgot this. Thank you. Happens on two levels, individual relationships and group dynamics. In other words, the process that we engage in coming into a place of one accord, first happens on the level of individual relationships. But then there are group dynamics that divide us as well. And these same principles have to be applied to these different groups that people identify with. You know, of course, our identity is to be found in Christ. Our identity is to be with the body of Christ. But, you know, a lot of people identify more strongly with their cultural heritage, with their gender, with their generational paradigms or perspectives or maybe political. But the body of Christ is to identify only, or primarily, I should say, primarily, principally, with the body of Christ and with who you are in Christ. But people still have to deal with the group dynamics. I mean, of course, as we grow in the Lord, that becomes our primary identity. Then, you know, these other issues, the group dynamics, become less divisive if they're mismanaged. If everybody could just see themselves in Christ and not as black or white or male or female or old or young or Democrat or Republican, if we could just see ourselves as being in Christ, then the world's problems would be solved. But we're not dealing with the world, remember. You can't come to a place of one accord with secular thinking. There's no way that will ever occur. So we're talking about the primary common cause that we have to embrace is to come together. Yes. It's to come together. Individuals within the church, and then churches with one another. And then we'll see the power occur, release. But we start by dealing with individual relationships. Husbands, wives, children, other family, siblings, you know, neighbors, co-workers, most principally those that are in your company that you're assigned to, because that's where you'll contact the majority of other believers on a regular basis. But we begin with individual relationships, and we begin by dealing with divisive influences. And there are four things that I think are significant in dealing with divisive influences. Communication has to occur. A lot of people don't like to deal with relationships that have become divided or where conflict exists. Nobody really enjoys that, so we tend to shy away from it. and to move away from those kinds of interactions with people. But communication has to occur if any divide is ever going to be bridged. And then a separation from certain divisive influences, which we'll touch on, refuse offense, submit to authority. We'll talk about each of these in some detail. I didn't get much past number two in the first service. We'll see how we do this morning. But first of all, you've got to communicate with people that you know you're not on the same page with, that God has joined you to. You know, you can't just ignore those things that push you apart, because the power is to be found in coming together. Amen. The blessing of God individually on a corporate basis is based on coming together. So you communicate. You know when you're not right with somebody. You know in your heart when, you know, division is existing in some form or fashion. And it almost always involves some form of interpersonal conflict. It could be the perception of interpersonal conflict, but, you know, perception or reality either has to be dealt with, because it'll keep you from somebody. And so you have to communicate about that perceived conflict of interest. Something you want to do that's not in somebody else's best interest, or something that somebody else wants to do that you don't, you know, you want to do the opposite, whatever I said, you know. You perceive that the other person's desire is not in your best interest, or vice versa. And so this will divide you. You have to go to them, and you have to initiate the communication effort by gaining their agreement that division cannot be allowed to exist. Now, anybody that knows the Bible knows the answer to that. The answer is that's correct. Division cannot be allowed to exist. Contention, controversy, strife in any of its many forms cannot be allowed to exist in the body. And anybody that is intellectually honest, who is a believer and knows the word, would have to say that's correct. So the first thing you do when you make the effort to communicate with someone that you're divided from is to get their agreement that this division can't be allowed. This conflict, this strife, whatever terminology you choose to use, cannot be allowed. And if they are grounded in the word, and if they're not stuck in having their own way more than they are doing the word, then they will agree. Now, you will find people, unfortunately, in the body of Christ who want to hold on. Want to hold on to their unforgiveness, want to hold on to their resentment, will not agree with you that things can be smoothed out, made right, that you can be joined together. They don't want it. They don't want to be shown to be in the wrong. So they say, no, that will happen, unfortunately. I don't think as often or as frequently as another person will, even if it's grudgingly, say, yes, this has to be taken care of, it has to be dealt with. But unfortunately, there will be people who say no. They're not going to let go. They're not going to put it right. They're not going to bridge the divide for whatever reason. And usually they're, you know, they're either marginal believers, they say they're a believer, but they've chosen not to accept the word as the final authority in their life, which makes them just that much short of being an unbeliever. And essentially, you know, these are the people that you, number two, separate yourself from. You don't hang around, try to talk them out of it, fellowship with them a little bit, be nice, be loving to them. No, you separate yourself from them. Word's very clear about it. Somebody that perpetuates contention and controversy that Romans 16, 17 says is contrary to the doctrine you have learned, what do? You avoid them. I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and controversies or offenses contrary to the doctrine you have learned. That is contrary to all scriptural doctrine. And it says, you know, people that fall in that category and are not going to take steps out of that division, then avoid them. Now, the word mark does not mean to publicly humiliate, as has been suggested in some quarters. The word mark simply means to make note of, to make mental note of. It says to mentally distinguish, but make note of. You make note of somebody that is not going to take steps away from the controversy, away from the conflict, and you put them out of your life. You avoid them. There's only one little problem, potentially, and that would be if you're married to them. And there is a different process you're to engage in. However, this is not a marriage seminar this morning. In general, you know, people that are divisive influences and will not take steps to resolve those divisions, avoid them, isolate them. God's basically saying the only way he can reach them eventually is in their isolation, their realization that nobody wants to be around them and listen to their criticism and listen to their backbiting and their gossip and their complaining and their whining and their murmuring. Nobody wants to be around that stuff. And so quit trying to love on them. Just isolate them so God can get to them. Amen. So essentially, this is the best way to deal with somebody that is functioning in that fashion. And there really is no doubt about it, you know. There are two kinds of rabble-rousers in the body of Christ, or I should say, people that thrive on controversy, contention. They're the ones that the enemy has assigned to bring division to the body. That's his goal. Jesus made the point, a house divided against itself can't stand. And he realizes what's going to happen on a global scale when the body of Christ comes together again as they did in the book of Acts in one accord. And so his best way to keep that from happening is to create division on any level that he can, whether it's the family, the church, or the nation. And so essentially, you know, the enemy will have assignments, people that knowingly cooperate with him. There are those people there. I think most of the people that create division in, you know, the body of Christ do so out of ignorance of the Word or immaturity in the Word. That's why you do go to them and say, you know, we've got to get rid of this and give them a chance to get on the same page. But if they say no, then you isolate them. And that's the best way for God to reach them and for them to ultimately have a change of heart and mind. But now, the communication process has just begun with believers that are in agreement, yes, this division, this controversy has to end. It can't be allowed to continue. Now, the communication needs to be focused on what exactly each person thinks the conflict is all about. Studies, multiple studies, have shown that almost 90% of all interpersonal conflict, get this, 90% of interpersonal conflict is based on misunderstanding. And so the second point of communication that we engage in is to say, okay, we're going to resolve this. What do you think the problem is? And get the other person to start telling you what their view of the conflict or the divide is all about. And you'll discover during the course of that conversation, both of you will, 90% of the time, well, you heard something. Hearsay, sometimes three or four people removed, that gave you an opinion about that person that was completely wrong, or about something they did, something they said. Or it could have been a misunderstanding during conversation. You know, when you delivered some information to them, you may have been, you know, distracted, emotionally upset, said it too strongly, and they consider your motive to have been something that it really isn't. All kinds of possibilities. But when you consider that 90% of all interpersonal conflict can be resolved by eliminating points of misunderstanding, that should make you excited. Amen. Because that is a fact, a statistical fact. And so essentially, you know, during the course of dialogue about your view of what the problem is, their view of what the problem is, a lot of the conflict you engage in can be eliminated right there. The third point of communication has to do with, I guess you could say, negotiation or compromise, not compromising the word. When you go into this kind of discussion, conflict resolution, you always have your refusal parameters decided in advance. I'm not going to go beyond this point, or I'm not going to go beyond that point. How do you establish your refusal parameters? The Word of God. The Word of God will tell you what your refusal parameters are. And so you're not going to go beyond these two refusal parameters on either side of this thing that needs to be resolved, that has divided you. If there is a problem that is uncovered during the dialogue about what each of you thinks the problem is, if there really is one, if there really is a point of conflict, then, you know, there on either side of that, the possible resolution to that conflict are refusal parameters that you'll not go beyond. I mean, if the only way you can come into agreement with your husband is to go to the bar with him and get drunk, well, no, that'll be a refusal parameter. You'll just have to say, honey, I love you, but I'm going to have to show it some other way because I'm not doing that. That's contrary to what I believe the Word says is appropriate. So the Bible always provides, you know, your refusal parameters. It's interesting to note that the same statistical studies say that another 7% of conflict, we've already resolved 90% of it through misunderstanding, by resolving misunderstanding, there's another 7% that is resolvable by being willing to give on methodology, but not refusal parameters, not exceeding refusal parameters. How do I say this best? Okay, we've all got goals that we want to see. Like, if I'm, you know, if we're talking about something on the associate level, I meet with, you know, 7 or 8 associate ministers a week, and we talk about stuff in the church and things that are going on and problems to be solved. And usually there's 7 different opinions, you know, because we're all different. But we all want to get to the same place. We want to accomplish a certain thing. So none of us have to forfeit what we feel is important. It's just a matter of negotiating, coming to an agreement on what the best method, the best strategy is to use in order to get there. And you can always make concessions in areas that don't require you to violate your refusal parameters in the interest of being joined in agreement with somebody. Hello? So, you know, don't ever be the kind of person that has to be right all of the time. The Bible says one of the keynotes of good leadership is being easy to be entreated in James chapter 3. And that actually just means willing to yield to reason. Yeah. So when you get to a point of controversy with somebody, but you still, you know, you got your refusal parameters in place, you want to move forward with the will of God, the plan of God for your lives and ministry and whatever, you know, it's just mostly a matter of how you're going to do it. you don't have to sacrifice anything of any significance. So go into the negotiation willing to yield to reason, to points that don't require violation of refusal parameters. And this kind of communication, 97% of the time, will bring you to a place where you can bridge the divide.
That's good.
Yeah. Then in addition to resolution of interpersonal conflict, we have another prime contributor to schism and division being offense. And so, refuse offense. There are two possibilities here. You can be the offender, or you can be the offendee. You can be the one that gets offended or the one that does the offending. First of all, in John 16, 1, we're told never to be offended. I mean, he says in his word that this is a point for us to all go to school on. You can't always do something about how someone else communicates to you. They may be offensive in something they do or something they say. You can't do anything about what they do. But you can always do something about your reaction. And so we're told early in the Word that we should never be offended. And the reason it's easy, it's really easy to get to a place where you're never offended is by understanding Ephesians 6:12, which says that your contest isn't with people. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Your problem is never the person that is harassing you. So don't ever take personal offense. Now, this is definitely a growing process. You know, we went through that media blitz a decade ago, and, you know, I didn't always do so well in not getting offended. But when you stop long enough to consider the truth of what you're confronting, it's not people. It's the spirit behind them that needs to be recognized as your enemy, not the person. I mean, Jesus did this with Peter. He said to Peter, "Get thee behind me, Satan." He didn't say, "Get thee behind me, Peter." He's talking to Peter, but he spoke to the spirit that was motivating what he said at that point. And he recognized the spiritual source that was, you know, really offensive to him in terms of his mission on this earth, potentially offensive to him. But it was the spirit behind Peter, wasn't Peter. And in the same way, the people that come against you, you know, it's not the person. And you need to consider the warfare they must be under to be that submitted to the influence of the enemy. I'll guarantee you, people that are the hardest to get along with, that are the meanest, that are the most difficult to interact with, are people that have got, you know, more warfare going on in their life than you could even imagine. Yeah. They got more stuff wrong, more problems, because when you submit to that kind of spirit, your life is going to be hell on earth. And so, you know, that understanding alone will help you pray for them and be compassionate for them, but don't blame them for it. Amen. Because they are definitely not the problem. It is the spirit behind it. And so it's easy not to take offense, really, if this verse is a reality to your heart and if it's something that you're mindful of. But then the word says not to be the offender, because there may be people that aren't as mature as others that can't handle it and they do get offended. And so you don't want to be a stumbling block to someone else, so pay a lot of attention to not being the offender. Offendee or offender. James 3:2 tells us clearly that if we learn to communicate, or as it says, if any man offend not in word, the same as a perfect man. That word perfect means mature. And able also to bridle the whole body. The horsemanship analogy is simply meant to point out that you can bring guidance to the entire body of Christ. If you learn to communicate without offending somebody. So what are the pitfalls in communicating with people that might make you inadvertently offensive? Sometimes it's intentional, but a lot of times it's inadvertent. The communication pitfalls can be described very simply as don't ever try to impose your will on someone else. God respects your free moral agency enough not to impose His will on you, even though it might be for your good. Don't ever try to impose your will on someone else. Now, you can be a good salesman. Do what you can to persuade them. I mean, certainly, you know, that involves evangelism. You need to be persuasive, but you can't force anybody to do anything. And a lot of times, bosses force employees to do certain things. Or friends force friends, either through intimidation or manipulation. They cause people to do something they really don't want to do. So always keep this in mind. When you have to use some kind of methodology to get someone to do something they really don't want to do, you have just blown it. That is offensive in one of the worst imaginable ways. And their defenses go up. When you offend somebody, they get defensive. Because on some level, they feel threatened by being faced with being made to do something, forced to do something that they really have no desire to do. Now, can't make these blanket statements without a few disclaimers. Obviously, in training a child, you're going to have to make them do things they don't want to do. Training is a different consideration. When it comes to obeying law, your flesh may not want to do it from time to time, but God does not endorse anarchy or chaos, and law has to be in place. And so there are times, of course, you may not want to do something, but other than these kinds of things, in your interaction with people, whether you're an employer, an employee, or a peer of someone, always protect the other person's freedom to choose. Make their own choice. Don't ever intimidate them. If you're an employer, that's positional authority. It never works. Be relationally skilled enough to cause somebody to want to do what you're saying they need to do. Being able to do it from their heart. A lot of times that means you give them an explanation why this is important that you do. Do you have to do that? No, I guess not. Not if you're the boss. But if you want good cooperation, then you need to respect somebody else's heart enough to say, this is really why this is necessary now. Now, there may be some occasions you can't do that. In the military, it doesn't work that way. Because you're in a combat environment. You can't say, hey, let me take a time out here. I want to explain to y'all why we need to do a flanking maneuver here. No, you can't do that. Orders are given. Immediate response is required. But in normal day-to-day interactions with people, you know, in any kind of leadership role, the more cooperation you can gain from the people that are working for you, the better off you're going to be. And that means trusting them to understand some good rationale here. And if there's a difference of opinion, then obviously authority is the tiebreaker. But make that effort. Don't ever force somebody against their will. Don't ever intimidate. Two Jewish guys, Hammond and Horstein, wrote a book in the 70s called Managing Human Resource and Organizations. And they came up with a great revelation of the day for corporate America. Corporate America ran on threats. Don't produce, you're fired. You know, you don't get the job done and get it done now, you're gone. You're expendable. And of course, their revelation was that if you can lead without creating a threat environment, without making an employee feel like their job security is threatened, their self-esteem is threatened, their self-image is threatened, their, you know, their integrity is being threatened. If you can communicate without creating a threat environment, you'll go a lot farther down the road of success in any corporate effort or endeavor. And part of what creates that environment is manipulation. People may not consciously be aware of the fact that someone's trying to manipulate you, but it feels icky. You know it. On a heart level, you know it. When somebody's trying to footwork you a little bit, obligate you, that's what manipulation does, obligate you to do something, you really should do this, you really should do that. Or they do things to ingratiate you to them. Now you owe them. Maybe you didn't even really want what they did. They did something nice, though, and they've kind of ingratiated themselves to you, and now you got to... No, that's an icky feeling. And everybody knows it when it's going down. And so whether it's intimidation or manipulation, you don't communicate that way. If instead you can relay your opinions, your instruction, your thoughts about a matter in ways that respect the other person's right to make their own choice without you applying pressure in any way or from any direction on them to do what you want them to do, but respect their free moral agency, then the communication will succeed. And now we can all agree on common cause and where we want to go together, and the process, the stage is set for coming together in one accord. There's one other element up here in addition to refusing offense, and that is submission to authority. One thing God is not in favor of is anarchy or chaos. He has set every office of authority that exists in the earth. It has been ordained by Him. If you've never read the 13th chapter of Romans, you need to do so, because the Bible says anyone who resists the authority that he or she has been placed under does so to damnation of himself. Well, this raises a lot of questions about abusive authority, because the Lord surely doesn't expect you just to be there on the receiving end of abusive authority, but yet He wants you to respect the office of authority that's being represented. How do you do that? How do you deal with abusive authority and still respect the office of authority, offices of authority that are set in your life, whether it's civil authority, legal authority of some sort, whether it's spiritual authority or in the home? How do you deal with abusive authority, still respect the office? We'll have to wait until next week to talk about that.